my sisters, I come to you in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus, I found a wonderful Savior. Jesus Christ, my soul delight. Every blessing of his favor fills my heart with hope so bright. This morning I would like to give thanks to my Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, who has blessed me tremendously. I should have been dead, sleeping in my grave. On many an occasion I escaped death, and I thank the Lord for his goodness and for his mercy. God has been good to me. I remember when I lived in California, I was driving on the 10 freeway, and I was driving right past Loma Linda. And I was in the lane all the way to the right, and there was a huge 18-wheeler to my left. And I can see the wheels turning next to me right here, doing about 70 miles an hour. And something said to me, what if that tire comes loose, spins out of control at 70 miles and hits your car? And I instinctively stepped on my gas pedal, and my car just spun forward. And as soon as I passed that truck, I looked in my mirror, I heard a noise, the tire came loose and spun right out of control there. Amen. I want to thank the Lord for saving my life and for blessing me. God has been good to me. I used to be a school teacher in Suriname, South America. I have a few years behind my belt. And I was a school teacher then, grew up a Roman Catholic, but then I met a young lady. I thought I was going to date the young lady, but she invited me to church. So I went to Sabbath school with her. And the Sabbath school teacher said that young lady there has enrolled you in Sabbath school. So I went back to Sabbath school because I wanted to talk to her. And the elder said, a young lady there has enrolled you in Bible studies. And I took Bible studies for 6 months. I ended up dating her for 4 years. And we got married. We've been married for over 43 years. Amen. Yeah. Thank the Lord for my wife. Amen. She encouraged me to go to Caribbean Union College in Trinidad. And that's where I studied theology and finally moved on to Oakwood University. Amen. God has been good to my wife and I. We have 2 daughters. And our daughters are not married. They're professional women. They like to roam the world. They just like their parents. Parents have lived in Suriname, South America, and Trinidad and Tobago, Canada, all over the United States. And we're not finished yet. Oh, no, 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 no. Next, we're going to live in Europe. We're going to live in Europe because we're citizens of Holland. So we just love to travel. Amen. Love to meet people. Amen. I would like to thank the Lord for your pastor. I want to remind you that it says in Genesis, I believe Exodus 23, that when a man has been married for a year, during that first year, he can go to war. He has to stay home for the sole purpose of cheering up his wife. He's still on his honeymoon. Amen. I want to thank the Lord for your pastor and his wife. Amen. Thank the Lord for each and every one of you here, for Elder Jason Tracy, whom I don't know, but he has ministered at the Alpha Agape Church for me. I pastor 2 churches in Miami. Very soon, I'm moving to Bradenton and to Sarasota. Amen. We just bought a house there. My wife and I bought a house within 2 hours. Mm-hmm. Don't take us long. Mm-hmm. We have another one in Alabama for sale. If you want to buy it, we're leasing it out. Wherever we go, we buy. We just do that. But no, it don't take us long. You know, when you've been married so long, it don't take you long to figure things out. Isn't that so? Amen. Amen. That's right. I want to invite all the married couples this afternoon. Let's come together and talk a little bit about relationships. Amen. This afternoon. But this morning, we want to talk about family life. Family life. And this is good. Some churches do a whole month of family life. I'm glad you're doing this, talking about family. And I like the quotation there that churches don't make strong families, but that strong families make healthy churches. Amen. If you would turn with me in your Bibles to Genesis 33, 1 to 12. Genesis 33, 1 to 12. Amen. I used to be the associate pastor at a large church. We had over 1,200 people in worship every week. And the senior pastor asked me one time, "Don't preach about relationships anymore." I said, "Man, telling me not to preach about relationships is like telling Kobe Bryant to retire. It's in my bones all over the world. That's what I do. Hawaii, Barbados, that's what I do. We just came back from Curacao. Before that, we were in Jamaica. And next, we're going to the Bahamas. That's what we do. Talk about relationships. That's what it's all about." Genesis 33, 1 to 12. I'm going to ask you to take your Bibles and read with me. Stand with me as we read together. Genesis 33, verses 1 through 12. Genesis 33, stand with me, let's read together. "And Jacob," everybody, "and Jacob lifted up his eyes, and behold, Esau came, and with him 400 men, and he divided the children unto Leah, and unto Rachel, and unto the two handmaids. And he put the handmaids and their children foremost, up front, and Leah and her children after, and Rachel and Joseph all the way in the back. And he passed over before them, and he bowed himself to the ground seven times until he came near to his brother Esau." Come on, let's read. "And Esau ran to meet Jacob, embraced him, fell on his neck, kissed him, and they wept. And he lifted up his eyes and saw the women and the children, and said, 'Who are those with thee?' And he said, 'The children which God had graciously given thy servant.' Then the handmaidens came near, they and their children, and they bowed themselves. And Leah also with her children came near, bowed themselves. And after came Joseph near, and Rachel, and they bowed themselves. And he said, 'What meanest thou by all this drove which I met?'" Everybody. "And he said, 'These are to find grace in the sight of my Lord.' And Esau said, 'I have enough, my brother. Keep that thou hast unto thyself.' And Jacob said, 'Nay, I pray thee, if now I have found grace in thy sight, then receive my present at my hand. For therefore I have seen thy face, as though I had seen the face of God, and thou wast pleased with me. Take, I pray thee, my blessing that is brought to thee, because God had dealt graciously with me, and because I have enough.' And he urged him, and he, 12, and he said, 'Let us take our journey, let us go, and I will go before thee.'" Let us pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, I'm lifting up this congregation before you, Lord. I pray in the name of Jesus, by the power of his name, that marriages will be mended today. Relationships will be restored. Homes will be made whole again. Wayward children will find their way back home. I ask that hearts will be healed, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Kindly be seated in the presence of the Lord. Turn in your Bibles to Genesis 25, verse 20, and follow along. Genesis 25, verse 20. And we're going to talk about family feud. Family feud. You know, when you mention the word family, what comes to your mind? You say family, people think about love, joy, fellowship, laughter, eating meals together, confidence, trust, loyalty, respect, honesty, cooperation, compassion. But may I also say conflict? It seems to me from reading the Bible and all the research that I've read, the social research, is that the word family seems to be synonymous with conflict. Somebody said, "Oh, that's because they're not going to church." Well, Genesis 25, verse 20 is a story about two church-going people. In fact, it's about a pastor, his wife, and two sons. You see, nobody gets a free pass. Nobody. There's conflict in every family. When I came to Florida, I was shocked. I had to learn a lot of things. When Elder Walden drove me to Miami, I said, wow, I'm like in a new country. Miami's a whole new country, different from any other place I've lived. I've lived in New York City, Los Angeles, San Diego, but this is different. One thing I learned about Florida is that you gotta have a sun pass. The president said, it's the thing in your car called a transponder. I said, what's it? He said, you call and you use your credit card and put money on it, because when you come to those cameras, you better pay some money. Better pay the 25 cents or you get a ticket for $100. Nobody gets a free pass. You see, in life, it doesn't matter how faithful you are. Nobody gets a free pass. Going to church, conflict. Praying every day, conflict. Studies have shown that healthy families are those that are able to deal successfully with conflict. Strong marriages, healthy marriages, are those that are able to process conflict, problem solve, not make love, problem solve, not romance, problem solve. One of the things I've done for my marriage to survive after 43 years is that I don't argue with my wife. Some older person told me when you have a conflict with your wife and she's wrong, you apologize. Well, what I do is a lot of things run to my mind, but you can't say everything you're thinking about. So what I bought is I bought a pacifier. Every time I feel like saying something, those of you who married know what I'm talking about. You can pick a fight maybe on Monday or Tuesday, but when you pass hump day and you know the weekend is coming, you can't have no conflict with your woman on Saturday night. Oh, no. That's time to hold hands and go walk on the beach and reminisce and dream. You can have no conflict. I put a pacifier in my mouth. Don't say it. Don't say it. Genesis 25, 20 talks about a man named Isaac. Who was Isaac? Isaac was the son of Abraham and Sarai. Genesis 17 says that God told Abraham, I'm going to make a covenant with you. I'm going to make you a great nation. He said, how can I be a great nation if I don't have children? God said, I'll give you a son. He was the son of promise. He was the seed of promise. Genesis 17 says that. He was the seed of promise. He was blessed. Then Genesis 24, 60 says there was a woman named Rebecca. Her family blessed her. Genesis 24, 60, they said, and they blessed Rebecca. And they said unto her, thou art our sister. Be thou the mother of thousands of millions. And let thy seed possess the gate of those which hate them. So here you have two people coming together, forming a dream couple, standing outright in the will of God. Two people in the will of God. A dream couple coming together, starting a dream marriage. They've got everything going on, the blessings of God. Genesis 25, verse 20 said, Isaac was 40 years old. His mother had died, and they selected a wife for him. And then he married a woman named Rebecca. She was 20 years old. I don't know what it is with older men and younger women. What is it with these men? Marrying a woman 20 years younger? I saw the other day a man married a woman 30-some years younger. What you gonna do? By 9 o'clock, you gotta be in bed, and this woman is just revving up. You gonna marry a 23-year-old, and you're 73 years old? She putting on perfume, you're putting on Bengay. What's going on? What's up with that, pastor? He's 40, he marries a woman 20. They've been married 20 years and she can't get pregnant. Well, is there an OBGYN here? A fertility doctor? She can't get pregnant 20 years. So here what she does, Genesis 25 says, she goes to her husband and said, you go ask the Lord why I can't have a baby. And the Lord blessed them. You be careful what you ask for, okay? Be careful what you ask for. I'm not kidding you. Be careful what you ask for. You're going to get it. She said, I want a baby. So the Lord told the husband, she's going to have a baby. Look at Genesis 25. 21, and Isaac entreated the Lord for his wife because she was barren. That means she can't have babies. And the Lord was entreated of him. In other words, the Lord was pleased. The Lord accommodated him. And Rebecca, his wife, conceived. Ha! She pregnant. 22. And the children struggled. Oh, she's having not one, but two. I told you, be careful what you ask for. She wanted one, she getting two. They struggled within her. In other words, there was a war going on in her womb. And the Bible says, and she said, if it be so, why am I thus? What's going on with me? And she said, go ask the Lord again what's going on within me. Hear what happens. 23, Genesis 25, 23. And the Lord said to her, two nations are in thy womb. Oh my goodness. Separate, hostile, unequal. How is it possible that two parents, a man, a woman, same egg, same seed, two children, and they're separate, hostile, and unequal? It says they're two manner of people, two nations in your womb, not two children, two nations. They represent two nations. It says they're two manner of people, two distinctly different kinds of people in your womb. How can the same womb produce such differences? It says, and the one people, power struggle now, and the one people shall be stronger than the other. Power struggle. I told you that. Power. Whenever you talk about family, you're talking about differences, you're talking about power. The one will be stronger than the other. Power struggle. And it says, and the elder shall serve the younger. In other words, role reversal. That's a problem right there. Right there. If you have two children and you're giving your youngest more than you'll give the oldest, you're going to have problems. So you have a power struggle and you have role reversal here. Trouble. This woman thought she was going to have a baby. Every Wednesday night, every Sabbath, she come to church. The women rub her stomach. See, the part of the world I'm from, South America, that's what they do. They rub your stomach. They tell you, oh, you're going to have a boy. Every time they tell my wife, you're going to have a boy, my wife had a girl. That's old people's wisdom. All kinds of stuff they do. Well, she thought she was going to have a good time. But this woman for 9 months had a war going on in her womb. She tried to sleep on her back. She couldn't. Tried to sleep on her left side, right side. She can't. She's a mess. Look what it says, Genesis 25, 24. And when her days to be delivered were fulfilled, 9 months gone, look what happened. Behold, there were twins in her womb. Huh? And the first came out red, all over red. How is that possible? Two parents, same parents produce two different children. Differences. Dream couple? Dream marriage? Differences. Look at that, differences. It says here, and the other one, it says, he was red, and he was hairy all over. He had hair all over. And they call his name Esau. He was the oldest. 25, 26. And after that came his brother, that's Jacob. And he held on to the heel of his older brother. Right there, trouble. You ain't going before me. Huh? And his name was called Jacob. Mercy. Dream couple, dream marriage, differences, divisions. Look at that, divisions. And it says Isaac was 70 old when, oh, what a blessing to be 60 years old and to have two rambunctious boys. 60 years old, man, you ought to be traveling the world. Somebody said, Pastor Whip, don't you miss your daughters? Yes. Don't you want them to? No, I don't want them to live at home. My wife and I just pack up and go. Pastor Whip, where were you in July? Jamaica. Where were you in August? Curacao. Where are you going next? Bahamas. Where are you going in the spring? Holland. I ain't got time to stay home and take care of grandchildren. Years old, and the man is blessed with two boys who fighting. Doctor is surprised first time he delivered two babies. Rather than slap them, they're slapping each other. What kind of thing is that? The man is 6 years old and the woman is 40. Now look what happens. And the boys grew, Genesis 25, 27. Esau was a cunning hunter. He was a skillful hunter. And he was always in the field. He was the kind of guy who would stay outdoors for 3 weeks, roaming in the field. Don't no shower. Don't brush his teeth. Don't floss, nothing. And his brother Jacob was just a plain man. You know, the other one was an indoors boy. One was an extrovert, one was an introvert. One who loved the outdoors, one loved the indoors. Differences. And look what happens here. The father loved the oldest one, and the mother loved the younger one. Differences, partiality. Some parents do that. They treat their children like that. They love one better than the other. You know, so the brother's out there coming home after 3 weeks with a dare on his shoulder, blood dripping all over, stink up the place. And his younger brother, the pastor with his toenails manicured. Ain't nothing wrong with that. I went to have my toenails done the other day. It feels good to have a Korean man work on your toes. He asked me, you gonna vote for Trump? I said, what does a Korean know about Trump? I said, yeah, he gonna send me back to South America. He gonna send you back to Korea. but the other brother is different. Differences, Pastor. Differences. The other brother's home, his fingernails really neatly done. He walking in silk pajamas and on the phone. He always texting, looking outdoors. Yeah, Mama, he coming home now, Mama. He ain't been home for 3 weeks, but now he's coming home. Yeah, Mama. I could see him outside. The other one is outside. Father loves the oldest one, division. Mother loves the youngest one, division. Dream couple, dream marriage, differences, divisions. Differences do not necessarily have to bring about division, but this is the way it's here. And it says, and Isaac loved Esau because he did eat of his venison, but Rebekah loved Jacob. She loved the baby. And Jacob was out there making some beans, and Esau comes home. He still has to do everything to prepare a meal. And he says to his brother, what you making? The brother said, man, I'm making your favorite meal. And he said, give me some. I'm hungry, man. And he said, well, what you going to give me? You see, he was a trickster. He's a con man. What you going to give me? You know, there are always people who want stuff. You know, you need to learn to give without expectation of return. That's the way your family's supposed to work. You give without expectation of return. But he said, what you gonna give me? And Esau said, well, what you want? He said, well, you know that piece of paper you have? What piece of paper? It's called a birthright. He said, oh, that stupid piece of paper. He had no appreciation for spiritual things. But his younger brother, he was cunning, a cunning hunter. But his brother was a cunning thinker. He was a strategist. He said, you give me that piece of paper, I give you food. He said, man, I'll take food any day over a piece of paper. So he sold his birthright. Days go by. Father grows old. He's almost blind. He has his own tent. He sits in his wheelchair all day long. That's the patriarch, Isaac. Mind you, he had the boys when he was 60. The boys are 30 now, he must be 90. They're grown now. He's sitting in his tent in his wheelchair, almost blind. Wife taking him to doctor's appointments all over town. Have you ever seen that? You never see that? There's always the women who make the appointment and the man stands there with a cane. No, I'm not kidding. My wife worked for 4 gastroenterologists in Huntsville. She'll tell you. She worked, it's always the wife making the appointment and the man standing there with a cane. Let me tell you something. Be careful now. When I was getting married, I was in my 20s. I saw something in Huntsville, Alabama. I saw an old white couple. I don't know why they always buy these big cars. These Crown Victoria 8 cylinders, the muscle cars. Brand new, big car. And the woman is driving and the man is in the driver's seat. The passenger seat. But I saw them again at Walmart on Sparkman in Huntsville. And I'm a people watcher. I love people. I love relationships. Like I told you, the pastor said, why don't you stop preaching about relationship? I said, it's like telling Kobe Bryant to retire. Never. That's me. It's in my bones. So I looked. I watched the couple. I'm a people watcher. And she stopped the car. It was a summer day. It was over 90 degrees, man. But I stood there in the sun and watched. And she got out of the driver's side. And I said, what's she doing? And then she went to the trunk. She clicked something and the trunk went open. You all have a car that you click something, the trunk goes open? You guys here are very modern man at Delray, man. The trunk went open. I said, what she gonna do? She took out the wheelchair. And I'm thinking, she walking, why she need a wheelchair? She took it to the passenger side. She opened the door, he sat in the wheelchair. And then I thought by myself, wait a minute. She closed the door. She wheeled them through Walmart. A little later to Walmart, I saw them and I looked at them again and I said, man, what if this man had acted ugly and she had left him in the car because he can't walk and she locked the car. Click, click. And she walking in Walmart, air conditioning is 90-something degrees in the car. I said, mercy, Lord. And he's sitting and she's pushing him all through Walmart. And he pointing, she picking up cereal here, cereal there. And he's sitting there. I said, man, I'm going to be careful with my wife. you all may get a message, past the whip. So come to the heat in the car. Sister Whip locked them up in the car, in the garage. It happens. Man, you be careful, man. The man is now old. The man is now depending more and more on his wife. The man is almost blind, and the man is coming near the end of his days, and he's vulnerable. The power shifts in the relationship. Do you know that social psychology talks about marital power? You didn't know that, did you? There's marital love, but it's also marital power. It shifts. Now his wife's in control. So he calls his older son. And he says to the son, my days are near. Go get a deer. Make me some venison. Bring it. And I'm going to confer the birthright upon you. And the son says, yes, daddy. And he leaves with his bow and his arrow and he goes away. And the mother is by the door. She heard everything. And she went to her younger son, her favorite. Some parents play favorite, you know. Be careful. Careful. And she says, son, this is what your father told Esau. He's going to give him the birthright. But you know that it belongs to you. So he said, well, what are we going to do? And she gives him a lesson in deception. Mothers, 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 why are you breastfeeding your baby? You're giving them lessons in love. Trust. But she's teaching her son how to deceive his elderly father, who's at the most vulnerable stage in his life. At a time when you grow old, you need to be able to trust your children. You need to be able to trust your family. But she gives her son a lesson in deceiving his father. And they pull it off. She gave him voice lessons. You know, when people want to do wrong, people are very creative. Do you know that? People are very creative when they want to do wrong. She gave him voice lessons. Then she did another thing, special effects. She wrapped him up with hair from an animal. And then she took some clothes from her brother, the soiled clothing, and rubbed it all over him. So he goes to his elderly father. The father said, are you back so soon? He said, yes. And then he tells a lie in the name of the Lord. He said, the Lord has blessed me that I so quickly found the deer that I was looking for. And the father eats of it. And then the father said, come closer. Ah, you smell like Esau. With a voice. And then he remembers the lesson because his mother is standing at the door coaching him. I'm talking about family life now. Mother, foundation of the family, is coaching her son to destroy the father who's the foundation of the family. Deceive him. And he's successful. And the father blesses him and he leaves. He comes to the door and his mother hugged him. We've done it. They're celebrating deception, betrayal, intimate betrayal. You know, the hardest thing is to be betrayed by the people you love most or the people who are supposed to love you most. Intimate betrayal. Oh, yeah. Intimate betrayal. There comes the older brother. He's in the yard. He's preparing his venison. He brings it to his father. And the father said, Esau, you've already been here. And he said, no, Dad, I'm just getting here. The father said, I already gave you the blessing. He said, no, Daddy, this is Esau. And the father said, my goodness, I've been deceived by my own wife, my own son, my flesh. What? Somebody asked me, Pastor Whip, how important are your wife and your two daughters? I said, that's the greatest achievement in life for me. My ministry is my wife and my children, my two children. Because when the day comes that I'm in the hospital and the tubes coming out of my nose, my ears, everywhere, who you think the doctor is going to call? The president of the conference? The union? The division? The general conference? Who you think they're going to call? My wife and my two daughters. Somebody said, who do you fear? I said, I ain't scared of nobody but my wife. That woman can say, doctor, cut him off. Take him off. Take them tubes off. He got two insurance policies. He leaving me two houses. Scared? Man, I tell you something. Esau is devastated. Devastated by the news. He said, Father, do you have a blessing left for me? And his father said, yes, I have a lesser blessing. And he gives him a lesser blessing. And the mother and the younger brother are outside. And Esau leaves the tent of his father. Oh, Genesis 27, 40. Genesis 27, 41. Mind you, same father, same mother, same womb produces two different children, leads to division and leads to deception. And one is devastated. And look what it says, Genesis 27, 41. And Esau hated Jacob. How can you hate somebody with whom you've spent 9 months in your mother's womb? But he hated him. Well, Pastor Webb, that's because they were not church-going people. Was Isaac a church-going man? Yes, he was the patriarch. Was Rebecca a church-going? Yes, she was the first lady of Israel. These boys grew up in Sabbath school. Esau hated Jacob because of the blessing with where his father blessed him. And Esau said in his heart, the days of mourning for my father are at hand. My father's old, sickly. When he dies, then will I kill my brother. And brother's been killing brothers ever since. Ever since. First murder in this universe. Cain, Abel, two brothers. And look what happens now. Rebecca heard that. Rather than dealing with the situation, rather than doing damage control, hey, look what? Esau's devastated. Jacob is disturbed now. He gonna kill me, mama. I can't fight him. She comes up with another lie. She goes to her old husband and said, honey, you know, Jacob, he has a whole lot of potential. You know that, don't you? You gave him the birthright. But I see how the Canaanite women are watching him. The Israelites hated the Canaanites. God cursed the Canaanites. They no longer exist. The Canaanite women are watching him. Let's send him away to my brother Laban so that the Canaanite women can get to him. And the old man says yes. And rather than deal with the situation, they enter denial. Denial. You know what denial is? Denial is like sweeping the dust. Help me. Under the rug. Never dealing with the root cause, but the symptoms. Covering up. Denial. We don't like to talk about AIDS. There are no AIDS in the Seventh-day Adventist church. No, we don't have HIV programs in our churches. Pastor, we have 2,000 people in worship. Do you have an HIV program? No. We don't talk about economics. How many of our members own a home? There are churches that economically empower their members. We don't deal with those. We don't deal with domestic violence. Domestic violence, oh no, it didn't happen in our church. Oh no, we have the Sabbath, we have the sanctuary, we have this state of the dead. We have, no. We. Denial. And rather than dealing with the situation, she goes to her husband and tells a lie, and the husband says, yes. And so what happens now when people have a problem? Flight. Jacob runs. Flight. The other response is fight. Esau wants to fight. It's either fight or flight. Esau wants to fight, and Esau stands there with rocks in his hands. And he sees mama take him to the bus depot with a ticket. And he leaves to go to Uncle Laban. Leaves his brother home devastated. And then the Bible says Esau begins to self-destruct. He marries all these heathen women in the community. He's paying his mother and his father back for what you all did, betray me. And he goes against their values. Nothing hurts more than you raise your child up in church school and Sabbath school. They go to Oakwood and they end up in prison. Nothing hurts more. Pastors having children doing time. Huh? Pastors having children doing time. Yeah, one conference president said when his son was arrested, he said, can't be my son. He went to church school. When he went to the jail to see his son said, you were never there for me. You were there for the conference, but not for me. But one runs, flight, leaves the mess behind. And the other one is standing home with the rocks. Angry, going to church, but Sabbath, but angry with rocks. And pastor is preaching hard, trying to them to do. They do no personal ministries, pastor, because their hands that they should use to love people are filled with rocks. They're nurturing their war wounds. They have grievance stories in prayer meeting. How people did them wrong. And they're standing with the rocks, waiting for the time they can pay the other person back. So he stands there and sees mama take his brother to the bus station and the brother leaves rather than deal with the situation. Ain't that funny? She's sending him to Uncle Laban. He's running into more trouble. He created trouble here, leaves it behind, don't fix the mess, runs now to a far country to Uncle Laban and doesn't realize that he's a con man, but Uncle Laban wrote the book on con. He's the master deceiver. Man, that Jacob, Uncle Laban, I still don't know. I got to go to heaven. I want to go to heaven. Pastor, I want to go to heaven. And when I see Jacob and Uncle Laban, I want to ask, how did you fix it? The man worked 7 years for a woman. The man spent his whole wedding night with a woman and in the morning discovered that he was the wrong woman. How's that possible, Pastor? That couldn't happen with me. You know, my house is exciting. Do you know that, Pastor? I have no children in my house. My house is exciting. Let me tell you how exciting it is. If you come to my house and I put this thing here, it'll stay here for the next 2 years. It don't move. Let me tell you how exciting it is. My wife likes to watch Andy Griffith and Barney Fife. I don't know why that tall woman likes that little short man, Barney Fife. I got to watch Barney Fife for her if I want my marriage to last. And then she said, we ready to go to bed. I said, okay, we say prayers, we say goodnight, and I turn the light off. And after I turned the light off, my wife said, did you bring water? Water. Well, at first I used to say, woman, if you need water, why don't you bring water? That's not a good thing to say. Especially when you're a man like me, you can't cook. The woman stopped cooking for a whole week. So I don't see it. There's certain things you shouldn't say. Buy a pacifier. I'm telling you, save your marriage. So I get up, I bring the water. I turn the light on. I stumble a little bit, hit my toes, but I bring the water. Then I turn the light off. She said, give me a kiss. The room is pitch dark. Now she's saying, give me a kiss. I'm going like in the dark. Can you imagine two grown people like that in the dark going and missing each other trying to give a kiss? So I get up again, turn the light on. My wife going like in the, now I turn the light on. She think I'm still in the bed. I turn the light on. She's like, what kind of, Pastor, what happens? The more we marry, the stupider, I don't know, we get. At least in my marriage. Man, the man spent a whole night with the wrong woman. How is that possible? I would have known right away. The minute the woman didn't, 2 minutes, a minute go by, and the woman didn't say, did you bring water? I know, I'm with the wrong woman. She didn't say, give me a kiss in the dark. I know I'm with the wrong woman. 7 years, Uncle Laban deceived him. Then he worked another 7 years and married him to the wrong woman. Then he finally married. Uncle Laban changed his wages 10 times. He ran into more trouble. Denial. People don't deal with issues. Rather than deal with issues, people run. Dream couple. Dream marriage. Dream family. Differences, divisions, deception, devastation, and departure. One is devastated, the other leaves. Departure. Denial. You know what denial is? People act like nothing's wrong. Nothing's wrong. And people don't deal with the issues. Let me tell you something, that conflict is an integral part of family life. Why is there conflict in the church? Because the church is made up of families. Families have conflict, the church has conflict. Conflict is an integral part of family life. The more intimate the relationship, the stronger the conflict is. Strong families are not those which never experience conflict. But strong families are those who are able to conceptualize conflict in a biblical way. They're able to process conflict, and they're able to problem solve in a way in which the needs of all the family members are met. When you problem solve, you got to make sure that the needs of your wife are met, the needs of your husband's met, the needs of your son, your daughter, the whole family must be blessed. Now, simply understood, conflict is a difference of opinion. Difference of opinion. You know, it's been shown that some people, you know, both people are right in the relationship and they're still arguing. There are cases where both people are wrong and they're still arguing. And there are cases where one is deadly wrong and the other one's right. They're still arguing because people don't argue about right or wrong. People argue about differences. People argue about differences. And sometimes people, they even don't even argue about the essentials. One church argue about, we don't want chairs, we want pews. Because when I'm sitting on a pew, it feels more like being in church. Is that an essential? Where in the Bible is a pews written? Where? Thou shalt have pews. People argue, when should we have communion? When did Jesus have communion? Did he have it on a Thursday or a Sabbath? Were the deacons there? Were the deaconesses there? Did they wear white gloves? Did they have silverware, goldware? When did he have communion? But people argue about non-essentials rather than essentials. That's why you need to go to premarital counseling so that you can hammer out the essentials in the relationship. Now, family conflict stems from differences between individuals. Family conflict is more likely to occur during the initial stages when the system, the family system, is being formed. That's when these conflicts tend to occur. And during the transitional periods of life, it tends to happen. And the more people involved in the conflict, the more complicated it becomes. Now, there are different ways that people deny conflict in the relationships. One of them is called displacement. Displacement. People are mad at this person, but they take it out on the other person. You heard of the man who went to work and his boss jumped all over him. Then he went home and he jumped all over his son, and his son jumped on the dog, and the dog jumped on the cat, and the cat jumped on the mouse. The weakest person always becomes the victim, because there is what we call displacement in the relationship. People deal with displacement in the relationship. Another one is disengagement. Disengagement is like people disengage emotionally. They act as though there's no conflict. And sometimes people live past each other, you know, we call them accommodation marriages. He's the head deacon, she's the head deaconess in the church. He drives his car to church, she drives her car. He lives upstairs, she lives downstairs. But they live in the same house because their children are grown. A disengagement. And then we have an argument, and his anger level rises from a 1 to a 10, and he storms out of the house, comes back 5 hours later with flowers, buys her a brand new refrigerator she wanted, and they never deal with a relationship. That is disengagement. People disengage emotionally. Disengage. That's why people have what you call emotional affairs. And then the next one is called disqualification. Disqualification is, I don't have a right to feel that way. You know, there's an uncle who's abusive, or he crosses the line in the relationship, touches the nieces inappropriately, but the parents are saying, you shouldn't feel that way. He's your uncle. Disqualification. You don't have a right to feel that way. Don't say anything. For the sake of peace in the family, don't say a thing. Disqualifying your emotions, your right to say anything. Very common among religious people. We don't talk about issues. We in denial. Displacement, disengagement, disqualification. So mom and dad maintain their standing in the family. Isaac is the patriarch. Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, the 12 tribes. God identifies himself. Am I not the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob? Dad maintains his status. Mom keeps her status with the women in the community. But the family is devastated because her beloved son is far away, while the one who's angry and hurt, he's home. And he's acting out in a self-destructive way. And he brings shame upon the family. I can't imagine. Can you imagine what family life is like? There's an old man who's growing old. When you grow old, your joy is your family. Your son, your daughter, your grandchildren. They surround you. But here you're sitting alone in a tent. Eyes growing dim, you're almost blind, you got kidney problems, you're going to dialysis twice, three times a week in a wheelchair. And your wife, elderly, she's sitting by the road waiting for her beloved son to come back home. And then the other son is acting out in the community, completely alienated. The family is completely disengaged from each other. This is a family within the will of God. This is a church family. What are the possible outcomes of a conflict? Number one, win-lose situation. Jacob wins. Isaac loses, but they both end up losers. Lose-win situation. One loses, the other wins. In this case, everybody loses. Everybody loses. One brother's home, the other one's there. He lays in his bed at night and he's thinking about what life is like. He misses his mama. He's a mama's boy. One's a daddy's boy. One's a mama's boy. And then God speaks. God has enough of the situation. And God calls Jacob. He appears to him. And he said, Jacob, go back home. Go back to your father. Go back to your mother. Go back to your brother. And settle the score. Problem solved. Work it out with each other. And look what happens. Genesis 33. Jacob plans to go home. And he leaves Laban. He leaves Laban. Genesis 33. Jacob lifted up his eyes and looked. He saw Esau coming. The man he feared. He couldn't stand up to Esau. Esau was a warrior. Here is Esau coming. And Esau has 400 soldiers with him, fully armed. 400 men. And when Jacob saw Esau coming, you see, Jacob is into power. He's into position. He's into prestige. Power, control. He understands violence. And so he sees his brother coming, and he comes up with a strategy. He's a strategist. And look what he does. Genesis 33, verse 1. He divided the children unto Leah and unto Rachel and unto the two handmaids. You got to understand, first he married Leah, then he married Rachel. But Rachel couldn't have babies. So Rachel gave him a servant called Bilhah. And Leah gave him a serpent called Zilpah. So he has four wives. The one he loves most is Rachel. Then comes Leah. Then comes Rachel's servant, Bilhah. And then comes Leah's servant, Zilpah. Look what this guy does. He divided the children. And what did he do? He took the handmaid that he loved the least with her children and sent him up front to meet the man. He's expecting his brother's anger level to be at a 10. He said, I'm going to send him first. He sends servants with gifts, and he sends the ones he loves the least first. But nothing happens to them. Then he sends the other servant with her children and with gifts. That's what it says. And then it says here, and he passed over before them. Then he sends Leah and the children. Then he sends Rachel. Rachel and Joseph, the ones he loved, are all the way in the back. So he sends one. A few hours later, he sends another group. A few hours later, another one. He feels that his brother's rage, by the time he's finished with them, his rage has gone from a 10 all the way to a 2. He can't handle that. And then it says in Genesis 33, verse 3, and he passed over before them. When he finally came to Esau, he was scared of Esau. He was no match for Esau. Esau was a warrior. It says he bowed before Esau. Can you imagine that? The man, there was a reversal of power. He was supposed to be ruler, his brother, the servant. He has the power. His brother is under him. But he bows now. See how he's changed now? Now he bows before his brother. How many times? 7 times. He shows respect. Humility before his brother as he came near to his brother. Verse 4, Esau did what? Run to meet him. Esau dropped his weapons and just started running. Mind you, the last time he was standing there with rocks in his hand and said, I'm going to kill you. Once daddy dies and I've mourned daddy, I'm going to take care of you. And now his brother runs out to meet him, and his brother did what? Embraced him. And did what? Fell on his neck, and the brothers did what? The brothers kissed each other over and over and over and over, and the Bible says, and they wept. They didn't rehearse all the mess. Some people like grief and stories. I know what pastor's going through.
People called Pastor. One woman called me one time. She said, Pastor Whip, you're a hard man to get in California. She said, I said, what's going on? I said, I noticed you called me yesterday morning. I was out. I came home late at night, but you called at 11 o'clock. I was already in bed. You called this morning 6:30. What's going on? She said, I finally found out what my husband's problem is. I said, lady, your husband is 79 years old. She said, when he was 4 or 5 years old, he went through a traumatic experience. I said, lady, the man is 79. He went through a traumatic experience when he was 4 or 5, and he's not over it yet. I said, when I'm 79, I do whatever I want under God. People, she wanted to give me 74 years of history. I said, I ain't got time for that. In the name of Jesus, I rebuke those generational curses. The brothers didn't go and rehearse all their grief and stories and lick their war wounds. They just run to each other, hug each other, fell on each other's neck, kissed each other over and over, and the brothers just cried. Because of our foolishness, the desire for position, power, prestige in the community, we alienated ourselves from each other. Verse 5. And he lifted up his eyes, that's Esau, and he saw the women and the children and said, who are these? And he says, the children which God has graciously given me. And then the handmaidens came and the children, and they bowed before Esau. Esau's supposed to bow before Jacob, but now, look at it now. He's learned the lesson now. And it says, verse 7, and Leah and her children came and bowed. And then Joseph and Rachel at the end. Verse 8. And he said, what meanest thou by this drove which I met? And he says, these are to find grace. He's asking his brother, whom he has wounded, for grace. And he calls him my Lord. Wait a minute. He wanted to be Lord, but now he's asking Esau for grace, and he's calling him my Lord. Verse 9. Look what Esau says. Esau wanted the stuff, but look what Esau says. I have enough. Bible says godliness, contentment. I have enough. Man, I had a meeting with one of the conference officials. He asked me, Pastor Whip, what about your future? I said, man, I have enough. I have helped. God has blessed me. All I'm asking for is help. Once your health is gone, everything is gone. These two brothers coming back together to God, restoring family, and they have their health. I have enough. He said, keep what you have to yourself. Can you imagine that? Esau saying that? And look what happened. And Jacob said, no, I pray thee, now if I found grace in thy sight. Look what he says. Receive my presence at my hand. Therefore, I have seen thy face as though I had seen the face of God, and thou wast pleased with me. Can you imagine? The last time he's walking away, he's looking at his brother. He says, rage in the face of Esau. But he says, now when I look at your face, it's as though I've seen the face of God. Isn't that something? Wouldn't that be beautiful? People come to daughter of Zion, and they said, when I went to that church and I saw the members, it was as though I saw the face of God. The usher met me by the door. It was as though God himself welcomed me. There was a deacon. It was as though I saw the face of God in his face. And then it says, he says there in Genesis 33, he goes on, verse 11, he said, take, I pray thee, my blessing that I brought thee, because God has dealt graciously with me, because I have enough. And he urged him, and he took it. And he said, let us go on our journey. Let us go, and I will go before thee. Two brothers just forgave each other. Two brothers fell apart for these things. Power. Position. I want to be the patriarch. And prestige. Let me show you something here about family life. Something about family life that is so important. I want to show you. This bottle represents your life. This bottle represents your life. Your life. Everyone is born like this. This bottle represents your life. This bottle here. Tell you what. You got to make sure that you understand the three most important things in your life. Don't fight for position. Don't fight for power, prestige. But understand first in your life, this is how you're born. God. Family. Your health. If God is gone, you're lost. Jesus said, seek you first. God, the kingdom of God. Realize that family is important. And then your health. Do not compromise your health. People say Seventh-day Adventists teach about health. Yes. And we tend to live the longest too. Black Adventists live longer than Adventists who are not Seventh-day Adventists. Does God love them more than the others? No. Lifestyle. The way we eat. The way we live. God. Seek you first. Family and health. Look what happens. Now the other things in life are important. I send my children to school, and I told my children the importance of education. I told them about the importance of education. I tell my children about education, having a career, making a good income, having a house, traveling the world, going places, enjoying your life, friends all over the world, you know, belonging to organizations, having memberships in important organizations. That's very important. Very important. There are so many things in life that are important, but first, you have God, you have family, and then you have health. And then there's the small stuff. There's the small stuff. There's the small stuff. Somebody said, don't sweat the small stuff. Make sure that the small stuff comes later that you're going to put in. The small stuff. Look here. That's the small stuff. I'm going to put the small stuff for you here. You can have it all. You can have it all if you do it God's way. You can have it all if you do it God's way. Hey, God, family, health. All these beautiful stones here represent the things in your life. You can have it all. You can have that car, that house, the position, the education, prestige, the finances, everything you can have. That vacation house in Hawaii, you can have it. It's possible. And then there's all that small stuff in between. You can have it all if you do it God's way. Let me show you what a lot of people do. Let me show you what a lot of people do. And when people come to premarital counseling, we talk about it. We talk about it, what people do. All right? Let me show you quickly. Here's another family, another person. This is their life. This is their life. But what do? They begin first with the small stuff. People don't have time for prayer meeting. People don't have time for morning worship. People don't have time for evening worship. People don't have time. People are busy. They're making that big salary. They have everything else. They have it. They work on the small stuff first. The small stuff. Now look what happens here. Next, they work on the stuff that they can enjoy. Work on the stuff they can enjoy.
Now they have it all.
They have it all. And finally, they grow older. Finally, now they want God in their life. Now they want God in their life. He don't fit. Now they want family in their life. There's no space for family. Before I became a pastor, for many years, you know, when I graduated from Oakwood, I didn't get hired. So I became a clinical therapist. I did a master's degree in clinical psychology, and I became a clinical therapist. I worked for the Department of Mental Health, San Bernardino County, and as a conservatorship investigator, where people were mentally ill, I took them to court, and the court provided conservators to take care of their business. And I dealt with the family. I said, would you like to be the personal conservator for your father? No. Why not? When we were little, he left mom and us, all of us eight, for another woman. Never took care of us. And now that he's old and he's sickly, mentally ill, we're not taking care of him. Let the state do it. You see, family no longer fits. Family no longer fits. Well, what about health? What about your health? It don't fit anymore. It don't fit anymore. Because people start the other way. I want to encourage you today to put God first. God first. In our family, God first. That means morning worship. That means evening worship. It means spending time with each other. Father, mother, son, daughter, go walk together. Turn the cell phones off. Telephones off. Go just walk with each other. Go visit grandma and grandpa. Give grandpa a shoulder rub. Give grandma a foot rub. Cook a meal for grandma and grandpa. Go sit and listen to the old stories that grandma and grandpa tell. Get some background. Get some roots. Forgive one another. It's not that deep. Your sister took your dress without asking. It's not that deep. Not that deep. Your brother took your basketball and went playing without asking you. Forgive. Reach out. My greatest ministry is now to my family. Day and night I'm praying for my family. I have a family member that has bone cancer. I have a family member that has a colon cancer. I have a family member who has a breast cancer. I have a family member who's in his 50s and he can't remember a whole lot of stuff anymore. I'm constantly ministering and praying with him. And I'm agonizing in prayer for all these people now. My greatest ministry is my family now. I want to see them saved. I go on vacation to Suriname. Other family members go on vacation. They said, we tourists, when we go home, when I'm in Suriname, I preach like a crazy man. And I'm also talking about relationships. How do you treat each other? How do you treat God? God said, you can have it all. All Jacob had to do, all Rebekah had to do, was do it God's way. And God would have given Jacob the birthright. Sad to say, though, Jacob got home. He said, Esau, after they finished hugging, how is Daddy? Daddy was just about dead when we left. He said, Daddy's still alive. But he said, what about Mama? Mama's dead. He lost all those precious years with his mother. The hardest thing I ever did was bury my mother. Part of me is buried in Suriname, South America, in a grave. That's my wife. Part of me is buried. Sometimes I get up at 2 o'clock in the morning, sit by my bed and just cry. I miss my mother. God, family, help. If this is what you want for your life,
stand to your feet and hold hands with each other, and we're going to pray together. We're going to pray because this is what you want for your life. Father, in the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, the beloved name of Jesus, your only son, Lord, I lift up this entire church family to you, daughter of Zion. Oh, Father, not just any church, daughter of Zion. I pray, Lord, that Jesus, through the power of the Holy Spirit, now begin to minister the word to the hearts and minds and the spirit of the husbands and the wives, to the sons and the daughters, the nieces and nephews, the aunts and uncles, the grandmothers and the grandfathers who are here. Everyone here belongs to a family. I ask, Lord, that you individually begin to visit each family and restore them. Restore love and compassion and forgiveness and kindness and courtesy. Anoint their lips, Father, so that they may learn how to speak life into each other's life. I pray, Lord, that you will anoint their minds, Lord. Renew their minds with the word, Lord, so that they may find new ways of relating to one another. Oh, Father, I pray that a total transformation will take place in each home, Lord. I pray in the homes that there will be peace among the family members. I ask that they will sit around the table, that they will eat with each other, that they will fellowship with each other. They will be patient with each other. They will be quick to forgive each other. I ask, Father, that you will protect those homes, Lord. Put your angels at the front door of their homes, the back door, the side door, all the windows, Lord. Bless them, family members, as they go to bed at night with Jesus in their mind. May they dream about Jesus. May they wake up in the morning with Jesus on their mind and on their lips. And I ask that in the morning, worship, Lord, as the songs are going up, that all heaven is pleased because this family is acknowledging the God of heaven. And then, Lord, I pray for this entire church family, Lord, that this church family will be totally transformed, Lord. We will go beyond being from the Caribbean, from being from Haiti and other countries and the United States, but we will transcend that, learning, Lord, that our citizenship forever is in heaven, and that we're preparing here at Daughter of Zion to live forever with Jesus. We pray for the pastor of this congregation. He is the shepherd of this congregation under the leadership of the Lord Jesus Christ. I pray for his wife as well, that you will anoint them, Lord, with a spirit from on high. Give him, Lord, with his wife, give them divine favor with God. Give them divine favor with the members of this congregation, with the leadership of this congregation. May they form a divine human partnership with him and with God and work together. And I pray, Lord, that this congregation will rise, Lord, here in Delray Beach, and that from far and near people will come to this place. And when they leave, they will say, it is as though we've seen the face of God when the pastor spoke at Delray Beach. Anoint him, Lord, with your power. May nothing that is planned against him stand. No weapon formed against him prosper. No tongue shall rise in judgment against him, but that only blessings will come to him, his wife, and his ministry. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Amen. As you're standing right now, is there someone here who doesn't belong to this church family, but you would like to have special prayer? You don't belong to this church family. Raise your hand and we'll pray right now. Pray right now. In the name. Amen. I see a hand here. You don't belong to this church family. Lord bless you. Happy to have you here. Is there another? Another sister here. The Lord bless you. Is there another one? Another. There in the back. I see some hands in the back. You don't belong to this church family. And we thank you so much. Raise your hand. Raise your hand. And I want to pray for you. I want to pray for you right now, Father, in the name of Jesus. We're praying for each and every person who is in the service today, especially the visitors who are directed by the power of the Holy Spirit to come and worship here at Daughter of Zion. I ask, Lord, that they found what they came looking for, Lord, and that they will make their calling and election sure at this church in the name of Jesus. I ask for those who are sick that they will receive healing. For those who are distressed, that they will be comforted. Those who are mourning and grieving, Lord, I ask that you pour the oil of salvation over their wounds. I pray for those who are raising children all by themselves without the support of a spouse, Lord, that you will be their banker and their provider. For those, Lord, who can sleep at night,
Give them sweet sleep, Lord. I ask for those who are in the golden years of their life, may these be the best years in their lives and the best to come. Father, I pray for those who divorce, that they might find acceptance here at Daughter of Zion and in the arms of Jesus. Let this place be a place where people can come when they want to meet Jesus. Hallelujah. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you.